Good morning. It is so wonderful to see you gathered together here this day. I pray that you are safe and sound through all of the Hurricane Ian episode. I believe that we can be very thankful that the Lord, by and large, has preserved this area. I hope that you are doing okay as well. My name is Reverend Kenneth Redmond. I have been with you now a couple times. I'm thankful to be here. As I mentioned to the early church, I'm a veteran of hurricanes. I was serving at Port Charlotte, so the Fort Myers, Naples, Port Charlotte, Punta Gorda area during Hurricane Charlie. And so we had the direct hit then. And it turns out that Ian also is a direct hit in that area a second time. So I will be headed down there a little bit later this afternoon after our worship is done here today. Our worship is in the worship folder, as you are accustomed to. We wanted to give special thanks to those who came out and helped do the cleanup here around the church grounds just a couple days ago. And also next Sunday is going to be LWML Sunday. And we invite you to consider celebrating with us next Sunday with LWML Sunday. So then, the Lord is in his holy temple. Come, let us worship the Lord.
We begin with the call to worship on
page one. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me.
Bless his holy name.
O bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all our iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit.
Bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, all his works in all places of his dominion. We make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand as you are able.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name. When the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain through the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name.
Gracious Heavenly Father, as we gather for worship this morning, we praise and thank you for your goodness toward us in Jesus Christ. We thank you for your grace and mercy towards us and ask you to be with us to bless this time that we have with you through the word and sacrament. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Congregation may be seated. Let us now confess our sins and receive God's forgiveness. O Lord, unless you are Lord of my life, I will get in the way of you being Lord of the church. My own desires, self-ideas, personal theologies tear down what you build up. Forgive me and give me a new vision for your kingdom. May I become a loving sanctuary of your love. My heart a living altar for you, that the church may grow and your kingdom come. The Lord hears the prayers of your hearts, and he says to you and me this morning, I will remove your sin as far as east is from west, and I will remember it no more. We praise God for his mercy and grace given to us through his Son, Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus, I declare to you that your sins are forgiven. Amen.
I'd like to welcome all the children up. I know I'm not Scott Wilcox. I am Katie Wilcox. Mrs. Wilcox, Miss Katie, either one will do. Come on up, kids. We're going to have our children's message. All right, I know Mr. Scott usually talks about the gospel, but I felt in light of what happened this week that we would talk about one of my favorite Bible verses, which is, this is the day, you guys say that, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Awesome. All right. It's really easy to rejoice and be glad in it when it's a beautiful blue sky outside and the sun is shining. We were so happy to wake up this morning and go to church on Wednesday. What happened on Wednesday? What happened this past Wednesday? What happened? There was a hurricane, yes, Hurricane Ian. And raise a hand if you lost power at your house, if the power went out. It went out of my house. All right. So some people lost power and some people didn't. We could see power lights from our house at our house. But so the storm came through. How did you feel? How did you guys feel when the storm came through? How did you feel? Sad? Oh, he felt happy. All right. Awesome. We were all feeling different feelings, yes. So you all made it without Wi-Fi. Some of you survived without Wi-Fi, right? I know I have teenagers at my house. That was kind of a big deal. So it's really easy to rejoice when the sun is shining, but on that day that the storm came through, we were still rejoicing, right? Because we knew God was with us, right? We prayed. And actually, for the people who lived in other states, we had people in all sorts of states praying for our state. That's pretty cool, isn't it? So God was with the people who were praying for us. God was with us. And God was also with the people who the storm hit the worst, right? So for them, it's really, they are having to find little things to rejoice in, that they still have their families, right? So this Bible verse works in so many different ways, but I just want you to remember that sometimes, even in the hard days, and let me tell you, after 70 hours of no power, it was a little rough at our house to find things to rejoice about, but we did, and we all made it through, and we keep Fort Myers and the people to the south of us in our prayers, right? So let's say it again together. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. All right, and you guys, take that with you today. I know last week, Miss Kathy was rejoicing a little bit more than Mrs. Wilcox was rejoicing when the Packers beat the Buccaneers. But anyway, so take that Bible verse with you guys, and remember, even on the bad days when things aren't going so great, you can find something that God has given you that you can rejoice in, okay? All right, have a good Sunday, guys.
The epistle lesson for this morning is taken from 2 Timothy, the first chapter. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, according to the promise of the life that is in Christ Jesus, to Timothy, my beloved child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God whom I serve, as did my ancestors, with a clear conscience, as I remember you constantly in my prayers night and day. As I remember your tears, I long to see you, that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now, I am sure, dwells in you as well. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a gift not of fear, but of power and love and self-control. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, for which I was appointed a preacher and apostle and a teacher, which is why I suffer as I do. But I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard until that day what has been entrusted to me. Follow the pattern of the sound words that you have heard from me, in the faith and love that you are in Christ Jesus. By the Holy Spirit who dwells within us, guard the good deposit entrusted to you. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand as you are able for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is written in the 17th chapter of St. Luke, beginning at verse 1. And he, Jesus, said to his disciples, "Temptations to sin are sure to come, but woe to the one through whom they come. It would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were cast into the sea than that he should cause one of these little ones to sin. Pay attention to yourselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day and turns to you seven times saying, 'I repent,' you must forgive him." The apostle said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." And the Lord said, "If you had faith like a grain of mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey you. Will any one of you who has a servant plowing or keeping sheep say to him when he has come in from the field, 'Come at once and recline at table'? Will he not rather say to him, 'Prepare supper for me and dress properly and serve me while I eat and drink, and afterward will you eat and drink?' Does he thank the servant because he did what he was commanded? So you also, when you have done all that you were commanded, say, 'We are unworthy servants. We have only done what was our duty.'" This is the gospel of our Lord. Let us confess our Christian faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, Congregation may be seated.
You are holy, holy,
Will you pray with me? May the meditations of our hearts and the words of my lips be acceptable to you, O Lord. Amen. The text that I have selected for this morning's meditation is from Jesus' teaching in the gospel lesson. And the apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." Thus the text. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, hearing this plea from Jesus' apostles, I wonder how often we reflect and can remember crying out to our Lord, "Increase our faith." Maybe it is right now. We anxiously awaited Hurricane Ian. Now that Ian has passed, maybe it is, how are we going to come up with all of this insurance deductible? Or maybe it is, how can I recover from this? Or maybe my family is devastated. But maybe it's not hurricane related. Maybe it was the last doctor's checkup to see if that radiation treatment for your cancer was effective. Or maybe that your heart has recovered at least a little bit from that heart attack. Or maybe to see if this chronic illness has any relief at all that we can find. Maybe when you said, "Increase my faith," it is not health related either. Maybe we think we need an increase in faith to manage our relationships, our wife or our husband, or perhaps our child and parent relationships. Dear Christian, in the living of these days, when and where do you find yourself crying out to the Lord, "Increase our faith"? I'll give you a moment. It is right and proper that we should ask ourselves these questions, because in the context of our gospel lesson, Jesus was talking to his disciples. Did you catch the opening verse? And Jesus said to his disciples. Luke reveals in his opening statements that he has set forth an orderly account of the life and times of Jesus. Luke wrote this orderly account so that the most excellent Theophilus and all of us who read this account may have the certainty concerning the things that have been taught about Jesus. Luke painstakingly interviewed eyewitnesses and ministers of the word to confirm that Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary, that he ministered in amazing fashion. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and good news is preached to the poor. Furthermore, Luke certified that Jesus suffered a most torturous and cruel death upon the cross. All of this, but more. Jesus conquered sin, death, and the devil. And on the third day, Jesus rose victorious from the grave. Jesus has now gone before us triumphantly into heaven to prepare a place for you. Dear friends in Christ, do you believe this? I'm asking, do you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead? The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Beloved in the Lord, this most fundamental Christian biblical truth that Jesus is Lord is what Jesus taught his disciples and apostles, and it is what Jesus is teaching you and me this morning. Now, Luke, of course, who was inspired by the Holy Spirit to write this orderly account, did so after Jesus was ascended into heaven. Therefore, we are considering Luke's account in retrospect, from a bird's eye view, so to speak. We are zeroing in on this small vignette of teaching. The Bible, very specifically, narrows that larger group from the crowds to the disciples to the 12 apostles. It was the 12 apostles who objected to such a radical repetition of forgiveness. The apostles cried out to the Lord, "Increase our faith." And I say, wait a minute. This is the 12 apostles. They were the inner circle. They were Jesus' prized disciples. They were among the 72 who were sent out two by two as lambs into the midst of wolves. Do you remember what happened? They came back to report to Jesus, "Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name." These are the 12 who were with Jesus at the Mount of Transfiguration. Remember that account? Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him up the mountain, and they were amazed to see the glistening white robes of the transfigured Jesus. Then, at the mountain, they heard the voice of God. "This is my Son, my chosen one. Listen to him." These are the 12 apostles of whom Jesus asked, "Who do the crowds say that I am?" And they responded that the crowds gave various answers. Then Jesus asked, "But what about you? Who do you say that I am?" And Peter, speaking for the 12, boldly confessed, "Thou art the Christ of God." Dear friends in Christ, do you get my point? My point is that if it is these 12 apostles who need an increase in faith, then what about us? Then perhaps we should not be surprised when we feel that our faith is falling a little short. The apostles pleaded, "Increase our faith." And how did Jesus answer? Jesus replied, somewhat matter-of-factly, "If you had faith like a grain of mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it would obey. Now that sounds like some kind of faith. So what is going on here? How are we to understand this confounding teaching episode? I believe that we can make sense of it. Let's examine it and try not to make it more complicated than it needs to be. Jesus opened his teaching segment with a warning, a dramatic woe to anyone who causes a little one, a child, or a new believer to sin by virtue of temptations brought to them. The heavenly hosts have rejoiced over the fact of one sinner who has repented. And now, for the one who causes a little one to sin, the heavenly hosts will call upon him, and they will give witness against him. it would be better for that tempter to die a very violent death, for surely eternal condemnation awaits them. Therefore, lesson number one, the importance of salvation. Then Jesus requires, pay attention to yourselves. Remember, Jesus is speaking to his disciples. Jesus proceeds to ask and speak about forgiveness. Jesus teaches them that if someone sins against them, they must rebuke their brother, and if he repents, they must forgive him. And if he sins and repents again and again and again, then we must forgive again and again and again. The second primary lesson, forgiveness. Therefore, our text is about preparing the apostles for living the faith and for leading others in the one true faith when Jesus suffers, dies, is buried, and is raised from the dead and ascends into heaven. The Lord is emphasizing the magnitude of salvation and the necessity of forgiveness. The apostles are to recall this lesson when they hear Jesus, who is hanging from the cross, pray, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Speaking on this text, Reverend Dr. Arthur Just, theologian, commentator, and seminary professor, says, quote, even though the apostles do not realize it, they have enough faith to do miraculous things, even something as remarkable as transplanting a mulberry tree, end quote. Our text is about remembering the wonders of salvation and forgiveness. It is about the mystery of the mustard seed faith that has potential to burst into a full-grown tree. For the apostles, they are to remember their individual and personal divine call to follow Jesus. They are to remember the Mount of Transfiguration, to remember what they themselves had reported, that even the demons were cast out at the name of Jesus. And they are to remember the confession of faith that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. For us, the text is about teaching us patience and endurance for our faith journey. For us, the text is about remembering the gifts of salvation and forgiveness that the Holy Spirit has showered upon us in our baptism. Hear the word of the Lord. And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Martin Luther said, we see what a great and excellent thing baptism is, which snatches us from the jaws of the devil and makes God our own, overcomes and takes away sin, and daily strengthens the new man. Baptism always remains until we pass from this present misery to eternal glory. Thus Luther. Beloved in the Lord, for us, the text is about the tangible gifts of salvation and forgiveness that we receive when we receive and partake of the Lord's Supper. Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, earlier I asked, in the living of these days, when and where do you find yourself crying out to the Lord, increase our faith? Upon examining our text more closely, I pray that you find that wherever and however and whatever your answer was, whatever your situation is, that for you, the increase in faith that you are encouraged this day, that you are encouraged that embedded within that mustard seed of faith by your baptism, that you have the power and promise of God to sustain you in the living of these treacherous days. Hear the word of the Lord. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with Christ in a resurrection like his. Therefore, please know that whether you are dealing with fractured relationships or health issues for you or for a loved one, whether Hurricane Ian has worn you down, you can call upon Christ who dwells in you. Hear the word of the Lord. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. God grant it for Jesus' sake. Amen. And the peace of God that passes all understanding will keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Our worship continues now on page 7. With the song.
Set free.
prayers of the church. God, we praise you for your great compassion and love in sending Jesus to be our Savior. Today, as we worship in the aftermath of Hurricane Ian, we thank you for everyone who was spared any injury or destruction to property. We pray especially for our brothers and sisters in Christ in Southwest Florida and all who are suffering either through the loss of a loved one or injury or a loss of property. Be with all who are responding to bring help and assistance to those in need. Today, as we learn about faith as a mustard seed, by the power of the Holy Spirit, increase our faith and trust in you, that we may be glorified in your name. And Jesus, you are our great physician. So we pray especially today for the successful cancer treatments for Rusty Cotterman and Tammy Smith, including her surgery. We also pray for Vicki Aiden, who is here visiting but hospitalized with AFib, and the mother-in-law of Pat Cook's niece, who is in critical condition following a car accident, and all other friends and family members that we now name silently and privately in our hearts and minds. O Lord, we also pray for our own congregation, our school, our teachers and staff, all our children and their families as we are going forward in ministry. We also pray especially for our senior pastor call committee, that you give them the gifts of wisdom and discernment. Prosper the work of our missionaries both here and abroad. Keep safe all our military men and women, and help each of us to share your love with those in our own circle of friends and acquaintances. In Jesus' name, amen. Please rise as you are able as we speak together the prayer the Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same manner also, he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Soften my heart, Lord,
Open our eyes.
Now may this true body and true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. 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 The closing hymn, page 10. As a reminder of the reason why we exist as a church, let us speak our vision statement together. Through word and sacrament ministry, we share the love, joy, and peace of Jesus Christ among ourselves and with those around us. Our worship has now ended. Our service begins. Let us go in peace.
She'll find it.